Your headphones are so fucking loud. Mm-hmm. And that's why we're deaf.
What?
Because your headphones.
And now, Cheese Whiz.
So, last week, or a couple of weeks ago, I'd asked her, and I wanted to talk about it last week, about, I heard this somewhere else. I did not come up with this thinking, but I heard somebody else talking about this on a different podcast somewhere, or on the radio, and it was...
There's a different podcast?
Yeah, there is.
Wow.
I think this might have been on the Conan O'Brien show. I heard this. Hmm. They were talking about song lyrics. They fucked up, and I wanted to hear if you guys had any. So I'm going to give you my song lyric that I forever fucked up. And mine was from John Cougar Mellencamp. And so I was, I don't know how old I was, 19, I guess, when that song came out. And I always thought that in the song, he said, when the bottle bounces and it'll save your soul. But what he actually says is, when the Bible belt comes and saves your soul. I fucking didn't know what a Bible belt was. I've never heard of a fucking Bible belt. I had no idea what the Bible belt was. Mm-hmm. Because it just wasn't something I learned about when I was a kid. But I think there's some funny shit. Like the other one that might get me too is what's the song? It's not Past the Duchy. It's I'll think about it later. But do you have a song that you've
know what just popped into my head? And it's a Taylor Swift song that came out. I don't know when did Blank Space come. I don't know 10, 12 years ago when Blank Space came out, and. What I think a lot of people thought the words were was something like, got a lot of Starbucks lovers that'll tell me I'm insane. But it was, got a long list of ex-lovers that will tell you I'm insane.
Well, I mean, that's reasonably close. What about Elton John and Hold Me Close, Tony Danza? Okay. Yeah. Or there's CCR, there's a bathroom on the right.
Yeah, yeah. And I mean, then there's always Jimi Hendrix. Wasn't it Jimi Hendrix? Yeah, Jimi Hendrix. Excuse me while I kiss this guy.
Yeah, those are. So so I had two, by the way, for that John Cougar Mellencamp, because he was John Cougar Mellencamp back then. I think yes.
Right.
The other thing we used to say, and you're probably not going to get the reference if you aren't from New England or weren't familiar with Boston television, but the other thing I used to think he said is, let Bob Lobel come and save your soul. Bob Lobel at the time was a sportscaster on WBZ television, and he was fucking phenomenal.
That's fantastic. And there was the
other person on that channel was Liz Walker, who was a pioneering black woman anchor, who was fucking. I saw her speak one time. And she was fucking phenomenal. She was just fucking phenomenal and inspirational. And part of what made me interested in news was her, which is kind of, but she was so, when black women really weren't in television that much, and this was in the very early 80s, but she was a fucking power broker of television. And but when I thought, let Bob Lobel come and save my soul. And I got laughed at and ridiculed horribly for that, which I should have because I was working in radio at that time, too.
Mm-hmm.
And I at that time, I was working at a radio station, and I was also still working in college radio.
But in your defense, you didn't have the internet to look up the lyrics.
No, but I did have an album jacket.
Did they always put the lyrics on album jackets back then? I didn't think all of them.
No, not all of them. But as you and I have established a little early before Chris got here, I know very few of the lyrics of almost any song ever, let alone the title or the deep lyrics. I don't know who's in the bands. Well, I don't know who. I couldn't name you all the Rolling Stones.
Along the same lines, there was a trend for a little bit on TikTok that was something like songs with lyrics that are actually kind of creepy and wrong. So Benny Mardonis, Into the Night, would be one of them. She's just 16 years old. Leave her alone, they said.
Young girl, right.
Separated by fools who don't know what love is yet. She's just 16 years old, man. Go away.
Well, we should have known that song, too, because we worked in Syracuse.
Yep.
And he was fucking huge in Syracuse.
Yeah.
He was a god.
Mm-hmm.
He really was. I don't know. It's sort of, we also, when we worked in Cortland, I lived off of Dio Way, which was, I guess, is it Ronnie Dio?
Ronnie Dio, yeah.
That was named for him. He was a fucking god in that area as well.
Wait, there was a street in Cortland, New York, named after Ronnie Dio?
Yeah.
Wow.
Dio Way. It was over by the Rubbermaid plant.
Hmm.
If you might even know where it was. It wasn't far from the station. Yeah, there was. So, what's another song that would be like that? Young Gary Puckett and the Union Gap, Young Girl.
Young girl, Sweet 16.
On the heart. Sweet 16. George Harrison?
Springsteen, yeah. I'm on fire. Hey, little girl, is your daddy home? Did he go and leave you all alone?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. So, there are a lot of songs. Look, there aren't a lot of girl songs that are perverted.
What's that, Chris?
That young girl thing. I said that young girl thing, it was a real thing. You know, with Benny Mardones, first of all, this should be a trivia question. What age was Benny Mardones a pedophile? How old do you think he was when he wrote that?
Yeah.
Jeez, I don't know.
16. Oh, God, 48. Isn't that terrible?
He was?
But no, he wasn't. I'm not even 48 Jesus yet.
Christ.
No, but, you know.
I'm looking it up while you keep talking, Chris.
You know, disc jockeys, Wally, as you know, have penises. And anytime they get a call on a request line back before the internet, hey, let's go show up at somebody's house. Well, somebody says they're 18 years old and you get over there and they're not.
And there's Chris Hansen.
Come home. This is from a guy in the 70s who told me that he went over to this girl's house who she said she was 18. She wound up being 13. And she's like, you got to hide. My parents are here. And the parents walked into the bedroom because they saw the car outside, started looking around, open up the closet door. And the guy says, hi, I'm blah, blah, blah from blah, blah, FM. I mean,
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Who the fuck does that?
Oh, so I'm just reading right now about Benny Mardones.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That song, he said before his death, was about some guy named Tepper who was talking about a 16-year-old girl, and Benny Mardones, his real-life conversation with him was, she's only 16, leave her alone.
So Benny Mardones was telling Robert Tepper to leave a kid alone.
Right.
Okay, there you go.
So Benny was not the pedophile himself. He was just writing songs about pedophilia.
Robert Tepper was the pedophile.
Right.
Got it.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
There you go.
We'll be right back.
I was expecting us to go in that direction.
No, are there any women's songs
like that? Are there any songs with women singing about young people?
About little boys?
So. Yeah.
I don't know about a song about women singing about boys, but there's a Garth Brooks song. What's it called?
The Beaches of Cheyenne, because there's so many beaches in Wyoming.
No. The one where that summer, I went to work for her that summer. Teenage boy so far from home. She was a lonely widow woman. Yeah.
Oh, it's an older woman.
Oh. Oh.
Mrs. Robinson.
Mrs. Robinson.
For you.
That is an older woman song.
Yep.
There's one.
You get the women and men with the underage in the songs. Take it to the most racist song you've ever heard. Anyone?
I don't want to.
I'm trying to think.
I'm going to share just for
everybody's fun. Kung Fu Fighting, maybe?
Oh, no. Well, I mean, you could. Look, that's racist, but there's 1960-something, and Casey Kasem had his flashback thing inside of one of his old episodes of American Top 40. It says, and here's a song dedicated to blah, 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 who met someone in Okinawa back in 1962. Whatever. And the song is called, I don't remember whether it's the boy or girl, but let's just say it's boy because I can't remember the specific racism. But I remember going down the road and hearing this beautiful medley. And then about 45 seconds into the song is, "You little Japanese girl, I'm not Japanese boy. Ching, ching, chong, chong, chong." That is a real fucking song. Look it up on YouTube.
And that's all we have time for today, folks.
Wait, there is another one. What's that song? Turning Japanese.
Oh, that's another one from the Vapors.
Right. I'm turning Japanese. I'm turning Japanese. And then they do a weird fucking voice. That's pretty fucking bad. That's pretty bad. And how about a song about race that ruined a guy's career? Am I Black Enough for You? Do you remember that song?
No.
Who is that?
So the guy who sang "Me and Mrs. Jones."
Oh, Levert, Gerald Levert. Oh,
Billy Paul.
Billy Paul. Yeah.
So I believe Billy Paul's next song was "Am I Black Enough for You?" And it ended his career for the most part. Because people are, and it's been used since then. People, I mean, I think black people have said that a lot. Oh, you're not black enough. They used to say that about Obama. You're not black enough. You're not this. You're not that. You're not this. But there are songs about race that also kill people's careers as well.
Yep.
So this isn't a new phenomenon. But songs about race, like, what is that song, Chris, that you were, what is that song? Do you know the song of the artist?
I'm looking for it right now because I don't see. I believe it's the Little Japanese Boy. Let me see if this is it. I'm going to pull it up on the YouTube real quick. Give me one second.
Yeah. So what I'm hoping is that any of the folks who listen will give us some songs they know that fit any of the bills of stuff we talked about.
Well, that would be cool. Chris gave out his phone number last week or the week before.
Whose number?
Chris gave out his phone number.
He did. I would like to see what, because we don't know every song. I can tell you my musical knowledge is very small,
which is actually kind of surprising considering.
Yeah, but I just because I guess here's my stance on that kind of thing. I know good music when I hear it, and I know what's going to work when I'm programming it. I don't necessarily like it because, as you know, Jess, when you're in the studio, you listen to very little of what you're playing.
Yeah.
Because mostly between songs, you're planning what your next, you're talking about what your next talk thing is, or you're quickly reading the newspaper, or you're looking at something.
Answering the damn request line.
Yeah. You're doing anything but, because normally what happens in the studio is, and if people don't know this who don't work in radio, normally the monitor is turned down.
Yeah.
So you're not even hearing except for your headphones, because your headphones are so fucking loud. And that's why we're deaf.
What?
Because your headphones your headphones
never gets old.
Unbelievably loud. And you turn down the monitor and you're either having a quick kibitz or you're fucking looking at something. Now it would be you're looking at for something on the internet, or you're back in our day, or back in my day, I'm looking at the paper or a book. But by the way, anybody who listens to this who might work in radio, go ahead.
I was going to say, or you're calling your competing radio station, winning their contests live on the air and saying your own radio station's name.
That was perhaps one of the best morning show bits we ever did. And we did it.
We did
all
it.
The time.
And they kept putting us on the air.
How we did it. So this is testament, by the way. When I say now I can't do voices, we were pretty good at doing voices back then.
Oh my God, we called in birthdays for last name Hunt, first name Mike.
We did all of that horrible shit, and then we used to record them and play it back to our listeners, and we'd win prizes and we'd play it back to our listeners and then give it away to our listeners. We were bad.
They would say, "What's your favorite radio station?" and we'd yell, "Kiss 102." Yes.
Was I say we were a crushing bunch of motherfuckers.
Yeah.
We were. We fucking left a swath of people. I was at 550 Music back when 550. So I was at Sony Music and I ran into somebody. I'd walked into Sony Music in New York and I was in New York for whatever reason, back when I was a big shot. And I was there and I was meeting with whoever. And they said, "Oh, Wally, come on in." And there's a girl who walks by and says, "Wally, hey, what's your last name?" And I tell her my last name, and then she said, "Do you work at a radio station in New York?" And I said, "Yeah, just outside of Syracuse." She goes, "Oh my God, it was the program director of the Syracuse University radio station."
No kidding.
"I listen to you and I love you guys. You guys are doing the best. You're the best radio people in the area.
Wow.
I love you." She loved us. But she only loved you and me. She didn't love anybody else on the station, but she loved you and me.
That's
fair.
She
said, "I steal stuff from you guys all the time." And then she's telling me about bits we did. Shit, I can't remember now. But bits we did and things we did and things we'd say and little mentions we'd do. Because back then, remember, there was a prison within our listening area. And we
went there to do a show.
Yeah, well, you almost...
For some reason,
found a lover there.
I don't remember why the hell we thought it would be a good idea, but I remember walking in and hearing one of the inmates go, "Is that a woman?"
Yeah.
And I was like, "I'm leaving. I'm out. I'm not doing this." Well,
so I'm thinking now, and this is the same thought I would have had then, and it's the same thought I have now. They're listeners. And this is
I used to get some of the best artwork from prison inmates.
Yeah.
My jail mail, the best artwork. But then they would like collect instead of saying their name, they would say whatever song they wanted to hear, or they would send a letter and ask for an autographed picture. And I was like, I am not going to be your,
some guy wanking off.
Yeah, no.
Whacking off to your picture.
No.
That was great, though.
Scooging on your face. You waking up in the middle of the night saying, "What the fuck is that on my face?" Like I'm just getting hit with a big load.
Those phone calls that you would get, "You have a collect call from Washington County Jail from Play the Supremes for me."
Yeah, that's exactly what you'd get. You have the whatever fucking prison it was. "Play Charles and Eddie." Play Would I Lie to You?
And you've got an inmate fucking sending you a song, "Would I Lie to You?" What the fuck do you think? Hey, can you bring that song up that I just sent you, Jess?
Oh, did you?
Can you bring that up on your computer and play it back for us?
Where did you send it to me?
I sent it to your AOL. Oh, Jesus Christ. To your Facebook.
My AOL. I'm not going to get it because I don't remember the password to my AOL, but let me see.
Hold on, you guys. All right. I know you're not going to believe this. Oh, you probably are going to believe this. My email is not AOL.
What do you got? Not, CS?
Yep. CompuServe.
I believe it. Yep. Yeah.
All right. Here we go.
Can't really hear it, Jeff.
Long, long ago, in a land far away, a little boy and a girl were so
in love. You can't hear it? It's loud. It's as loud for me as it is. Hang on.
No, we heard it a little bit
down the line.
Disappeared.
We don't have a license to play music anyway, but.
Oh, well, I don't think anybody's going to get us on Bobby Goldsboro.
Bert Bacharach. He just died a couple months ago.
Yeah, I sent it to you too, Wally. It's Bobby Goldsboro singing "Me Little Japanese Boy, I Love You."
Shut the fuck up.
I sent it to your AO. God damn it, to your messenger.
Hold on. I like Bobby.
This is a real record.
Hold on. Ready?
Yep.
See if my. Can you hear it?
Yep.
A little bit.
Nope, it went away again too.
Yeah, it blocked it out.
That's weird.
I wonder whether it's their licensing blocking it out.
I bet it is. Nope.
Can't hear it, Wally. Wow, that's funny. Well, listen to it on your own time.
Yeah, it's called...
And then get back to us.
What's it called?
Little Japanese Boy, I Love You.
Yeah, that.
Bobby Goldsboro. Yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty fucking horrible.
Are you listening to it, Wally?
Yeah, I listened to it. He's going, me, little Japanese boy, say, yeah, I love you, you little Japanese girl. Yeah, it's even...
That's pretty fucking bad.
The stunted language in it is the most offensive part of it.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
It's sort of like one of those kinds of, you know, when people talk to somebody, go like, how are you feeling?
Like, he probably thought he was being flattering when he sang that song.
What's that?
Said he probably thought he was being flattering to little Japanese boys when he sang that song.
Probably.
Didn't sound so flattering. You know, what about, speaking of stuff being a little bit racist, how about an absolutely horribly racist television show? How about Hogan's Heroes?
I never really watched that.
Oh.
Nine.
Hogan? It's very, very, very stereotype. And very stereotype.
That Bob Crane was filming that between snuff films. That's yeah. Great.
Oh, yeah. He was a pretty well-known, I guess, you know what? So we didn't know about it. People watched the show, but I'm sure it was well-known in Hollywood that he was a...
pornographer?
Yeah, a fucking wackadoodle. He was a weird motherfucker, that guy. He was fucking crazy. Him and also the original Superman guy.
Reeve?
Christopher Reeve?
No. The one who played in the black and white...
that guy. Man. Oh.
Yeah.
I can picture his face. I can't think of his name.
Yeah, I can't remember his name either, but he ended up murdered, I think.
Over a snuff film?
It had something to do with sex, and I think that a lot of that shit, when I hear about some of these old, a lot of it had to do with being homosexual, or some of it had, I don't know that I should say a lot of it, but had to do with homosexuality and being homosexual and hiding your homosexuality and having what then would have been called perverse sexual hungers or cravings.
Still, which, is in Tennessee.
Yeah. Yeah, well, in Tennessee and a lot of other places, mm-hmm. that are not in the Northeast or on the Western Seaboard, yeah, there's a lot of that. But yeah, I think a lot of that had to do with, you know, what was normal practice now, and was just life now. It's just life. Those fucking folks trying to live, you know, a life in the shadows, and like everything else in life, when you're on the edge of something, somebody's capitalizing on it and making it fucking dirty or making it, you know, heinous, when it's just fucking life.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, so that you're forced to lurk, even though you don't want to lurk, but lurking would get rid of your, you know, you lose your career. By the way, who's the senator in, who's that senator in North Carolina? Is it North Carolina? Lindsey Graham? The fuck is with that guy? what the you see him on TV going, give money to Trump so he can save himself. It's like, fucking Trump, by his admission and by others, is a billionaire. He doesn't need anybody's fucking smokes, Budweiser, and TV dinner money to save his ass. Pay your fucking double wide rent and leave. Don't send him a fucking dime.
Yeah.
And let that fucking guy defend himself. Now, I'm not making any determination on whether he's guilty or an asshole or he's innocent. I don't care. I really don't care. Let the justice, let it do what it does.
Mm-hmm.
But stop fucking, if you're a billionaire, stop fucking begging for people to pay your fucking bills.
Amen to
fuck
that.
You.
God
pay
almighty.
Your own fucking bills.
Typical liberal bullshit. Good God, Wally.
fucking that dude. I'm gonna call fucking George Soros and see if he'll pay some of my fucking bills.
Oh, I think he should. I'm sorry, I just walked in the house and the cat hasn't seen me in a couple days, and I swear the tabby cat looked at me and went, hello. I swear to God.
Yeah, you have a special bond with your cat, don't you?
You know what, there are four of them around here. One of them I hardly see. One of them, the little tabby, is just, he's my good little boy. Then there's a black cat who is an asshole, and I wish he would take a long walk outside. And then there's a brown and black that is a long hair. That, do you want some treats?
Yeah, I know you do. Here you go.
Oh, I hear the cat.
Yeah, that one talks to me all the time.
I hear
it's
the
so
cat.
Crazy. And I hate cats. I fucking hate cats. But I love these two guys.
Did you see what Jess is wearing? She's wearing a Janet Jackson shirt.
What's she wearing?
Janet Jackson shirt.
Is that what that is?
This shirt.
Right over Jess's right breast, she has Janet Jackson's breast. Right?
This shirt came from when I was at YesFM.
Really?
Sharon Steele went to the concert, and I filled in for her so that she could go.
Ah.
And she brought me back this T-shirt.
Sharon Steele?
What's that?
Sharon Steele?
Yeah, the real Sharon Steele.
Was Sharon Steele, was that her middle name? Was her first name, hey, everybody, I'm...
The real
no Steele. Nope.
No.
But listen, Chris, Wally and I both worked with the real Sharon Steele. And then that was in Cortland. And then in Rome, Utica, we worked with Shannon Steele. And then Sharon Steele came up and did a show with Shannon Steele, or they were back to back. She filled in or something. And then there was a guy who went by Aaron Steele, who I feel like maybe he filled in court. I don't know. But all of that to say, a couple of months ago, I went to lunch to meet this record guy to talk about some of his artists. And his name was Michael Steele. And I said,
I know Michael Steele.
Which, come on.
He was working records when I was. What label?
No, he was. It's a little independent label. And I asked him, I said, is your name really Michael Steele or did you come from radio? And he said, I came from radio.
So did Storm Kennedy. We had a weather guy named that. Well, let me tell you something about the real Sharon Steele.
Yeah.
Chris.
The late real Sharon Steele.
He had a fucking voice.
Yeah.
That would stop you in your fucking tracks. She was so fucking smooth on the air.
Mm-hmm.
It was she had this soft rasp in her voice that fucking guys, they loved her voice. And on the air, she just knew what she was doing.
Mm-hmm.
She was a little, she needed coaching and shit, but she was just fucking so good, that kid.
Yep.
She was really, she died some years ago in
2005, I think.
Huh?
I think it was 2005 when she died.
Yeah, weird circumstances.
Childbirth.
But her on air fucking work was so good. But she could never fucking get out of where she was because she, and this is the reason why, for real with her, she hooked up with some of the worst motherfuckers ever.
Yep.
She had no fucking judgment in men, and she hooked up with the fucking worst people.
I tell you what, though, the guy that she married, he was a good dude.
I don't know him. It wasn't Frosty. The guy I remember was Frosty, and Frosty was...
Oh, I remember Frosty. No, he was trash.
Yeah, Frosty was trash. By the way, Shannon Steele married the guy who used to be our engineer and was her boyfriend, the guy who fell out of the truck.
Yeah. Yeah. The guy who filled up our on-air board with duct tape because he didn't know how to fix it.
We had an engineer. We didn't have a real engineer. So one of our jocks, the APD and music director at KISS, her boyfriend at the time, he would come and do the engineering work. And his most favorite piece of engineering equipment was duct tape.
Yep.
He used it. We were doing a pub crawl for St. Patrick's Day one year.
You talked about this last week.
Oh, did we mention how he fell out of the truck?
Yeah, last week or the week before.
Oh, God. That's fucking... But I was talking to her about it the other day, and she got her... She just got her real estate license.
I saw that.
By
the way, completely different subject. Chris, we were talking about how much it costs to bowl these days.
Yeah, we talked about that last week.
Yeah, and I was listening back to that episode to make sure that everything in it needed to go, you know, go on the air. And when we got to that part, I Googled it. There's a bowling alley up the road from me here, and it's $3 for shoes. And I didn't see how much games were, but I did see a New Year's Eve package where six people could bowl and get all of the food and all of the shoes and everything for $115. So I think your shit's just expensive up there.
Maybe our shit is expensive here, but we get it.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, if there's no competition costs less, then yeah.
So what's the difference in the location? So Chris, in Chris's area, is there a lot of places to go do shit as opposed to, you know, so my thinking is the fewer joints there are to go do something, the more expensive it's going to be because it's supply and demand. And maybe in Nashville, there's 8 billion places you can go and do something. So it's much more competitive.
Well, yeah, there is a lot to do in Nashville, but there's a lot to do in the DC area.
Well, in DC, yeah, but there's probably only one fucking duck pin bowling alley.
Yeah. That's true. And this was a regular bowling alley.
Yeah. And there's no duck pins in DC. The closest you get to duck pins in DC is Suitland, which is, I don't know.
Yeah. So I tend to think, and plus, so duck pin bowling, I don't know a lot about it what I do know about duck pin bowling is if duck pin bowling is your thing, you are fucking married to it.
Hmm. That is absolutely correct.
So you're going to pay that money because you don't want a fucking 10 pin. You don't want a candle pin. You want a duck pin. Even though the other things are called fucking bowling, it ain't duck pin bowling. I ain't doing it. I ain't doing it. I do know that because I've known a couple folks who duck pin bowling was their thing. And it was, they were just completely into it, and the other bowling was not even, they wouldn't even consider it. They just wouldn't. So yeah, you're gonna pay for it. If you love it, you're gonna pay for it.
Well, and that's just it. I mean, but some of the 10 pin alleys around here are higher priced than I am.
Huh. Really?
Oh, absolutely.
I think shit's just cheaper down here for the most part, except for like housing, which used to be a lot cheaper down here and now is probably on par with the DC area. Because yeah. It's an it city.
I couldn't afford to get a house here anymore. I mean, my house, I just sold my house in Germantown, mm-hmm. like in September, and I was coming off of the top of the market, and I got $370 for it. So
maybe we're not quite as expensive, because that was a townhouse, right?
Yeah, and it was 3-bedroom, 2-bathroom.
Oh, okay. So mine was smaller.
I can't fucking understand that kind of thing. Because I know our house is, you know, if we put it on the market, it'd probably be in the somewhere between 5 and 6. And I wouldn't pay that for it. But, and it's, I don't know, it's probably, what's that?
But you're in the middle of fucking nowhere. That's a lot of money.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, it is a lot of money, but it's 25 acres, it's water frontage.
That property here, you'd be in the millions.
Oh, yeah, but I can't fucking understand. That seems so unfair to life. It just how the fuck do young people get anywhere with this kind of fucking
the American housing situation? Yeah, the American dream died.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I heard, my son was just telling me that not far from here, maybe 10 miles from where I live, they're building an 1,100 unit housing complex, high rise.
Oh my God.
Which would be the first one in the area because there isn't a lot of housing. Now, I think maybe he might have read, it's probably going to be, it probably meant to say 110 housing unit. But that's a fucking huge, huge housing.
That sounds like what they're doing all over Nashville because They're knocking down the stuff that people want to come to Nashville to see so they can put up more condo high rises and hotels.
And that shit's all corporate too. Most of that shit is corporate. There's, you know, 3 or 4 very large real estate developers in this country that develop most of that shit.
Mm-hmm.
And they're making fucking millions. They're also the folks who help bury banks by,
yeah,
you know, selling those units at ridiculous prices to people who can't afford them, they're also the people who help facilitate the crushing of banking mm-hmm. or banks, and also the crushing of just people who want to fucking get ahead and want to have a fucking place to live.
I will say there are programs, you know, when I bought my house 10 years ago, I had no intention of buying a house. I hadn't saved up money for a down payment or anything, but the guy I was renting the house from didn't want to be a landlord anymore. Yeah. And at that point I had a pit bull. I was paying less than $900 a month for rent. And I wasn't going to be able to find rent that cheap or find a rental that would allow me to have a pit bull. And so I started looking for options, and I got one of those first time home buyer loans where it was like two separate mortgages. One was just for the down payment and closing costs.
Yeah.
And that one actually, I never paid anything on it after had I owned it for longer than I did, it would have started what I owed on it would have gone down incrementally every year. So after 5 years, it would have gone down 20% and then another 20% every year after that. So if I had kept it for 10 years, I wouldn't have had to pay that back.
Sort of like becoming a teacher and working in an impoverished area.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. You know what? The fucked up thing about that kind of, it's great that it was there for you.
Mm-hmm.
You shouldn't fucking have to have programs for if you're a woman, if you're a veteran, if you're a this, if you're a that, if you're an immigrant, if you're black, if you're white, it should be affordable to fucking everybody. There shouldn't have to be, you know, all kinds of, and this is the fucking great part about government, and the worst part about government is we don't want government to be in your life, but they fucking keep making these ridiculous programs because, well, I know somebody who needs some help who's in my family, so I'm going to create this program mm-hmm. for rich people who can't afford really, really big houses. What the fuck?
Oh, my God. Once again with this liberal bullshit. Jesus Christ.
You guys, I don't know how many people want to listen to us talk this long at one time.
Well, you could make it into two episodes. That cures our problem for when we're out of town, don't it?
Maybe.
Yeah, you could have episode. This week's episode is... And cut it. And you know what? If you do decide to do that, cut it off really fucking awkwardly, like in mid sentence or something.
Tune in next week to finish this sentence.
Right. Next, will Wally say this or will Chris take a shit?
You know, we should do like those old school radio promos and like have a jingle song. You know, it says, next time on the Cheese Whiz, we'll talk about when Benny Mardona's. Trying to get a little girl and Robert Tepper at the same time. Plus, we're going to talk about Wally and Fish coming up next time here on the Cheese Whiz.
That would be fucking awesome.
Start having cliffhangers.
Yes. Yeah, so
that's why we need to get more people to do the ratings and to go on that wherever they do that stuff so that we can fucking get some advertisements.
Apple Podcasts. That's where we need you to go. Even if you don't listen on Apple Podcasts.
Yeah. And just reach out to us too. Send us a note or something. So, you know, he's going to get some idea. I don't know how all that shit works, Jess. I don't know if you look at it or if you even had a chance, because I know you've been way too busy to see if, hey, we got two listeners this week.
I don't know. I haven't looked at the listening statistics in a while. But I mean, if somebody sends us a note, you know, messages us on Facebook, on the Cheese Whiz page, one of us will see it. You're on that page more often than I am, Wally.
Yeah. I post things here and there. What did I post? Didn't I post something the other day?
Something, Gil.
What did I post the other day? I posted the shit picture. Oh, I posted my, my acting.
Oh, that's right.
That's right. On the John Ritter show.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Where you look so concerned. Hey.
Yeah. Yeah. But did you hear? I had voice work in that.
Hey, watch out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Watch out. Watch out. I've seen myself in quite in other things as well, but that's the only one I had a speaking role in.
You know what, though?
How many fucking people can say that? I mean, it's easy. I look back at it now. It's easy to mock and look at and sort of say, fucking big guy.
You know, the only reason we're going to mock you for it is because we're jealous it wasn't us.
You know what, though? Some of the fucking funnest times of my fucking life was doing that shit and hanging out with it. You know what kind of fucking weirdos you meet
work
in the arts and especially television and movies? You know,
yes.
Do you have any idea how fucking wackadoodle Diane Cannon was?
Really?
Oh, my God. She was a fucking wackadoodle. And Thelma Hopkins, who was in Dawn, I did a movie with Diane. I did a movie with Diane Cannon and Thelma Hopkins, and this was, I think she'd already done, she probably already shot the family, whatever that show was called.
But you don't give me a break at that point, or was that after that?
Oh, no, I think it was after that. It was when she was, well, it was 1987, maybe.
So Family Matters times. No, yeah, that was
Family Matters.
87 was still Give Me a Break. That went on
a bit. So, okay. So, but she got on, and so here's where my musical knowledge did come in. I didn't know much about anything, but when she rode on a bus with us, she rode on the bus to the set to where we were shooting. I think it was called Rock and Roll Moms or something like that. Mm. And I said, oh, Thelma Hopkins, you're the best. And she said, well, how do you know me? I said, you're in Dawn. And she sang Dawn song. She sang Tony Orlando and Dawn. She sang the Dawn song, whatever. I don't remember. Now I can't remember it, but then it was, 40 years ago. That's awesome. It was closer to my memory. What was it?
That's awesome. I love hearing that.
Yeah, she was so nice. She was so nice. She was just a nice, regular part of it. And she wasn't a huge star at that point. She was a star, but not a huge star. She was probably a B star at that point. I met some... It was just fucking a great fucking time. And I almost got run over by Gene Roddenberry on Paramount Studios.
No kidding.
Yeah, fucking. And now had it been today, had I known back then what I know now, and I had a camera, I would have fucking taken pictures of him. And he was driving on the lot. Very few people could drive on the lot, but he was driving on the lot with his gray ghost, whatever kind of car that's a Bentley or something, Rolls Royce. Because right across the street, I worked on a show called Bronx Zoo, and you left at a certain time and they'd shut down the set and you had to leave. And I was there late with a couple other friends. We were fucking around and we hadn't left the studio, and we're on the set of the Bronx Zoo in the school, and we're looking out the windows and we're seeing fucking these weird people walking around. They look like, like an alien or something. They were shooting the pilot for the first Star Trek New Generation show.
Oh, wow.
But could you imagine having a fucking cell phone then where you could have sold that to the National Enquirer for?
Right.
You could have sold that for a fucking, because they didn't want, it was a close, they didn't want anybody on the set. They didn't want anybody seeing, because it was such a big secret back then.
Mm-hmm.
No, I had a fucking, what else they were shooting back then was solid gold. You used to see those solid gold dancers. Oh, yeah. I used to see those solid gold dancers up close because they were only a couple sets over from where we shot. They're right near Cheers.
I was positive I was going to be a solid gold dancer, and look at me now.
Them with some good looking women.
Hey, I was always positive I was going to be dancing on the bar at Cheers. It's so weird.
same.
But that whole little area was Family Ties, Cheers, Solid Gold, Bronx Zoo, all were shot in that. And there was a bunch of other shows too shot in that area.
Wow.
Tell me about Meredith Baxter Burney. Wasn't she something?
I never met her. I met Michael. We used to go over to the, because they were a big show, and big shows got fed on the lot. And
right.
Shows like Bronx Zoo did not. So we used to go over there and steal their fucking bagels and their food. We'd go over because we were a young cast and we were all fucking poor and we were fucking starving. And we go, who worked on my show was, what's her fucking, Catherine Harold? Who was?
Catherine Elmond.
Harold. She was the girlfriend on a comedian show on HBO, faked a talk show, pretended he had a talk show. What's Gary. His name? Yes. Yes. What's his name? Gary what?
Gary Shandling.
Yeah, the Gary Shandling show. He was her girlfriend on the Gary Shandling show. Wasn't her name Catherine Harold?
I don't remember her name, but I remember they changed the theme song of the show the one week that her first week on the show.
Yeah, she was a twat.
Yeah, well, she looked like a twat on the show.
Yeah, she was a twat. She was absolutely fucking a vicious bitch.
Wow.
Yeah, she was on that show. She was nasty. I also did Max Headroom a lot, and I did Dallas quite a few times.
It's amazing how they could have a TV show based on fucking Captain Midnight. You know what was even the purpose of Max Headroom? I never understood it.
It was just so futuristic, right? But look how close it is to reality.
Well, yeah. Now that we got them AI DJs,
yeah. Now, so listen to that Drew Carey thing. Listen to him. What are you looking up?
I was trying to see what Catherine. Are you thinking of Catherine O'Hara?
No, not Catherine. Just look for the cast of Gary Shandling.
I did, but Gary Shandling's been in a lot of shit, and nobody. Catherine Harold.
Yeah, Catherine Harold. She was.
It was the Larry Sanders show.
Yeah.
Oh.
Gary Shandling had a show called The Gary Shandling Show, and nobody named Catherine was in it.
No, yeah, the Larry Sanders show with Gary
Shandling show. I forgot about the I forgot about Larry Sanders.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there you go. There's my little thing. But yeah, I had fucking such an awesome time in that part of my life. And it gave me a lot of I got to grow up a lot and experience a lot of life. And I'll tell you what, driving to California when you're like 24 and living on your own in a fucking flop house hotel is a fucking big education, let me tell you.
A question kind of Hollywoodish. I'm just kind of curious. If you're watching a movie, can you separate in your head, can you separate the actor from the crime? Like, I love Kevin Spacey movies, but it was kind of, can you separate the actor from the crime? I try to, and you know, I just get into the movie after about 5 minutes, I forget about it.
Yeah, no, I can't all the time because whenever I can't do that with artists either, because whenever I hear Lenny Kravitz talked about, all I can think of is he's a fucking woman beater.
Hmm.
You know, because the story, you know, that he used to beat the shit out of Lisa Bonet.
Really?
And that's I can't separate that. I just can't separate. Depends on, I guess, the kind of crime and what my sensitivity is to that kind of crime. I think that's it. I think that, if it was fucking, you know, it's easy with, if it's pot smoking or drugs. That one's an easy one to overlook because it's a illness and it's a different kind of thing. But when Robert Downey gets arrested for, you know, his ridiculousness or what's his face, punching a transsexual when he's getting a blowjob, the English actor. Oh, I can't think of his name right now, but anyways, him. No, that's easy to separate that shit because that's just. But when it's.
But what about like a pro football player who murders his wife?
No,
and then continues to play football.
I can't erase that.
Yeah.
That I can't erase. Violence towards people that's plotted, planned, super heinous to folks who are less able to defend themselves. That stuff I can't fucking erase. Mm. But if you're fucking, you know, you did something because you're a fucking. Robert Downey or whoever, pick a fucking drug addict, you know, then, or I don't even want to say drug addict, but someone who has an issue with substance abuse.
Wait,
Robert Downey can get away with, huh?
So wait, Robert Downey did drugs?
Lots of drugs.
All of them. All of the drugs.
All the ones but now he's a success story. People should be looking up to that fucking guy.
Yeah.
Because that's a guy who
turned his shit around. Die.
He was about to die
from
drug abuse. And he fucking somehow turned. Or Keith Richards. You can look up to him, too. I think that fucking guy, he's just fucking inside. He's
going to outlive all of us.
Oh, he's fucking unbelievable. That guy has done enough drugs to fucking keep, you know, San Francisco in business. So much drug. He's just unbelievable how he's able to fucking do it day in, day out. And at his age, still be, you know. Able to even speak or sing or play a guitar is crazy.
Yeah.
Crazy nuts. Here we are talking about being 50 and 60 going, oh my God.
Well, apparently we didn't do enough drugs.
Yeah, that's what we got to do.
You know, speak for yourself.
Poor 40-year-old, poor 40-year-old Chris, poor 50-year-old Jess, poor 60-year-old me. There's 82-year-old Keith Richards going, come on, let's play the guitar, drink some beer, shoot some heroin. Come on, let's go. And we're fucking, come on. I had to pick up 3 boxes and then I had to rest for fucking 3 hours.
Right? They're still doing shows that start at midnight. And I'm like, I got to be in bed by 8:30. Are you kidding?
I know. I'm the same way. But so here's my problem. And then I guess we got to go. I cannot sleep past 4:30 in the morning.
Is that why I picked from you at fucking 5:15 in the morning thing?
That's why my AM drive, you know, biological clock will not turn off.
I couldn't get up at 4:30 in the morning when I was doing morning drive.
Yeah, but I could. I could. And I still do, and I'm still away. And it doesn't mean I'm really function. I'm able to function great, but I'm awake and I'm ready. But I still my big problem is I don't have the mobility. It takes me a half hour to get out of the fucking rack, even though I'm awake. It's my eyes are open. It's like someone's giving me that drug where your eyes are awake and you're aware of everything, but you can't fucking move. Whatever that shit is, that's me. So I'm sort of I'm aware of everything. I can fart.
Oh, good. Thank goodness.
Farting is possible, but that's about it. The rest of it I can't do. The fucking cat jumps on me. Oh, hurts me. I can't move. I'm fucking, it's like the arthritis kicks in. Okay.
All right. We will catch up with you guys next week.
All right.
Y'all be good now. You hear?
Bye.
Bye-bye.